more
Doris
than
Doris told me you would attend. I'm so excited.
Well, this is near dear to my heart. Really? My father died on the TV.
That's different than Uncle Frank, sure.
Especially Doris, Everett, and Yan Chen, and Donna. And we have been working together since middle of last year. For me, and I started a journey from last year, and looking for my uncle. And he is one of the Chinese Air Force and died in US for the training. That's because start from 1941, U.S. and help the Chinese and to start to build the Chinese Air Force. Actually, within last year, I got a chance to know many friends and also to learn more about this part of the history. And so I got a lot of support from U.S. and China and Taiwan volunteers. Without their help, and we cannot find 23 families of these Chinese Air Force, among the total 57.
Thank you, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Michael Lambert. I'm the acting city librarian for the San Francisco Public Library. It is my honor and privilege to welcome you all to the Chinese Center here at the main library. We are so excited to host this opening ceremony of the exhibition, Looking for the Sealed Memories, U.S.-China Air Force Alliance, War of Resistance. This exhibit is critically important in highlighting a little-known chapter in United States history, but also in the history of the People's Republic of China. And I want to really acknowledge Ann Lee, who organized this exhibit, and she has worked tirelessly in search of these airmen's remains over the past year. To date, she has found 23 Air Force families and over 50 Chinese Air Force tombstones in Fort Bliss, Texas. So let's give Ann a big hand. We have a number of special guests today who you will be hearing from later, but I do want to acknowledge Assemblyman Canson Chu. Okay. His father was also a member of the Chinese Air Force. I want to recognize John Easterbrook.
Okay, go ahead, okay.
Yes. John's grandfather was General Joseph Warren Stilwell. I also want to recognize Captain John Angel Chu. Captain Chu was a member of the Chinese Air Force's 4th Brigade. I also want to recognize Connie Young Yu. Connie is a board member of the Chinese Historical and Cultural Project, and she is also U.S. Captain John C. Young's daughter. I'd like to recognize Russ Lowe. Russ is a son of a U.S. Airman from the 14th Air Force Brigade. Let's also recognize Steve Chang. Where's Steve? So Steve is a son of a a Chinese Air Force pilot from the 5th Brigade. I also want to acknowledge Doris and Chuck Chan, who do great work with the World War II Veterans Volunteers.
The issue, you know, not until I met with Ann a few months ago that I learned that his uncle actually came to the United States with the same boat of my father. They went to Phoenix and get their training. My father was lucky to survive the war, but he was severely injured during the war. So one of my efforts in the State Assembly is to make sure when we update the curriculum, and we wanted to include more of the what happened during the World War II, especially in the CBI theater, in our history curriculum, so the student, the next generation, be able to learn more about the sacrifice both of our country have made during the World War II. So with that, I have two certificates of recognition. I definitely wanted to thank the San Francisco Public Library to open up this space and to do this photo exhibit and educate the people, the visitors of the library about this, again, not so well-known history. And also definitely wanted to thank Ann Lee for her tireless work and working on this issue and educating me about some, you know, World War II history that it wasn't, I didn't know about earlier. So there was a really, really good education to me. And I would like to ask Ann Lee and the representative from San Francisco Public Library to come up here and receive a little token of appreciation.
This exhibit is important for several reasons. One reason is that photographic evidence shines a light on the true history of a period. And in this case, of U.S.-China cooperation during World War II, that has been in darkness for far too long. Historical photographs are wonderful for documenting and exploring history, or developing or renewing friendships. Some years ago, I took a series of historical photographs to Kunming. These photos were of General Stilwell and a group of Kuomintang generals. They were taken in Kunming in 1943. In China, they were viewed with great interest by a number of historians. In one photo, there was a little girl of about 8 or 9 years old standing in front of all these generals, rather a curiosity with all these military men. One of the Chinese historians over a period of about two years was able to locate this little girl. And she was then living in Beijing. She was the daughter of General Huang Wei. Shortly thereafter, I took Huang Minnan good copies of these photos that she was in. She was most appreciative as she had never seen the photos before, and we had become good friends ever since. Based on my experience with a similar photo exhibit in Taiwan, you'll be very warmly welcomed there. When she takes the exhibit to mainland China, she will join a group of Chinese citizens who have been working to bring to the Chinese people the true stories of events during World War II. For many decades in China, the complete history of events during the war became lost to the people. It has only been in the past couple of decades that private Chinese citizens have undertaken to bring the contributions of Chinese national soldiers and the assistance America gave to China during those years to the Chinese people.
We gather here today
to pay tribute to a group of young patriots who gave up their education and instead, enlisted in the Chinese Air Force in World War II.
I'm the son of Lam Fu Chen, who served in the Chinese Air Force as a fighter pilot to fight Japanese aggression in China during World War II. My father joined the Chinese Air Force Academy at age 17. He and Lian's uncle, Li Jiahe, and Kenson Chu's father were classmates and good friends. In February of 1943, they joined pilot training in Arizona. After completing basic flight training and instrument flying, my father and Kenson's father continued their training as a fighter pilot. And Lee moved to a different airfield. My father never heard from Li Jiahe again. In April of last year, my father read an article in Chinese World Journal magazine about Li Jiahe and found out that he had been killed in a bomber flight accident. The article was written by Lian. To my father's surprise, Lian reached out to him. A few months later, after she learned my father's story from her friends, one of her friends.
One person does make it, can make a difference. It's very obvious. And this is one of the missing chapters of U.S.-China history and Chinese-American history. And now it is part, is going to be incorporated in part of the bigger story of what happened in Asia during World War II. And we know that our children, and we probably didn't learn much when we went to public school, but what happened in Asia? We knew about the combat and the conflict in Europe. And this exhibit here is actually unfinished business. It's just the beginning. Thank you so much, Anne.
The song, Qilai, to rise, because when my father was overseas, he sent my mother this sheet music on very thin paper, and he said, teach your children this. Teach my Connie and Janie, my sister, teach them the words to Qilai. And so here we are in our house in Whittier. This is my mother, my older sister, myself, and my cousins who came from San Francisco for the occasion, and one, two. So he was a very tall pilot. We just remember him. He could just hoist us on his shoulders easily. And my grandparents were just thrilled to see them.
We sort of got involved with 14th Air Force with my late uncle, Eddie. He went back as a guest of the Chinese government, as did some of the veterans. For the 70th anniversary of the end of the war against Japan. My uncle Eddie was born in Connecticut and was up onto the East Coast. A lot of these men, not only did they serve over there, but when they came back to America, they had to continue to fight discrimination.